Welcome again, everybody. Thank you for joining us for the second panel discussion of today. In this panel, we will be speaking about the politics of acquiring performance. We will be talking about museums and archival institutions acquiring performance art and how to overcome the issues that come with this specific practice of collection, financial issues, practical issues, legal issues, and to start from the case of Augenmusik, a site-specific intervention in public space by Katya EV. It is a work that was acquired by the MUCA in 2019, and as it's a very complex work, it rose a lot of challenges, and it's challenged the standard infrastructures of an institution. So I'm very honored to introduce my guests for today. Next to me is Katya EV, an artist who has developed a time-based performative practice in which she engages with issues of power dynamics and control, institutional critique, and the potential for individual agency within these dominant power structures. We would like to share the trajectory of Augenmusik, of the acquisition Katya and the MUCA went through together. Before we get into that, it's crucial to get an understanding of the work, and that's why I would like to give the floor to Katya, who will give us an introduction about the work.
Hello to everybody, and thank you very much for inviting me. And I'm very glad to be here. And in the first place, I would present the performance so that it becomes based database discussion. And I will have to go there to the computer and to do this. So the performance Augenmusik was realized in Paris in 2016. Here's the image of the performance. And it was realized in a very special context. In the end, 2015, there was Parisian attacks, and that were followed by the state of emergency that was installed in France. And that caused a lot of social resonance. There was an Occupy movement on the Square of Republic during almost 7 months. And the state of emergency also was unprecedentedly long. It lasted between November and July. The moment of state of emergency, and then this social movements was moments when there was a huge and like sort of a non-return point to the security state that got in place in France, and there was a lot of police violence and abuse at that moment, and state of emergency precisely became a state of exception, as Giorgio Agamben calls it, which basically gives more power to executive power instead of legislative power, and becomes a sort of a gray zone itself, where the pretext of emergency is used to strengthen the state control. And so at this very precise moment of new history, this performance was taking place in the streets of Paris. So, yeah, here you can see the map of Paris, which has a circular structure. And in blue, you have the itineraries of the performance. So there were 24 people who were standing, each of them on the gate, on the ring road of Paris, on the outside side of the gate, all of them were holding police emergency lights in hands, and all at the same, precisely the same moment at 9 in the evening, were starting the movement towards the geographical center of the city here. It is also geometrical center of the city. So I will maybe here put the short video excerpt. They were walking quite slowly and quite ceremonially. Each of them were alone. And the important aspect of the work is that in their backpacks, they were having the batteries for the lights, but also sirens. In this moment you see that how she's crossing the gate into the ring road. So they were basically taking over the city, all of them, like entering into the city space. And so I was saying that in their backpacks, they were having, this is not the right video. Here you have an image from the making of, and so there was this sirens there, and so each siren was playing a bitonal, as it was playing two tones from a French police siren, but actually all together, the sirens of all performers were playing simultaneously the Art of Fugue of Bach, which was not audible because they were all spread all over the city, and that was only becoming audible in the moment they were getting into one sound zone. And here I will have the expert, the making of video, so that you can hear the Art of Fugue all together. I can show you the, and here, they were starting their movement at the daytime, at 9 in the evening, but the time they arrived to the central point in the city, it was already nighttime. And so now I will show you the, they were arriving progressively, one by one, because each trajectory was, the length of each trajectory was different, and because the rhythm of their walking was different. And so each of them was arriving to the central point, putting the emergency light with the siren on the floor, and silently walking away. And so the Art of Fugue was progressively shaping itself on the central, square. And here there will be an excerpt that maybe I should put in the middle. So for example, the disrupted sounds that you hear now, it's because there is the number of sirens is not complete, and you have like only 12 of them. But with each next performer, so the video that you are seeing now is documenting this final scene from the very beginning, from the first person that was arriving to the last person, and so it's a video that allows to understand how the Art of Fugue was getting complete. Wrapping up my presentation, I'm going to say just a couple of more things. That the police sirens were true police sirens that were that I managed to buy from the subcontractor of French police, but in a legal way, because the subcontractor doesn't have any restrictions to sell them actually to whoever. And another important point of the work is that it was not a commission of any institution, or it was not done in the frame of a festival or whatever. It was rather realized on an actionist modality, meaning that people just arrived, started to walk, put their sirens, and that's it. And it's an important aspect of the work, because at the moment of state of emergency, the right for gatherings is severely compromised. Actually, you cannot be more than 10, officially cannot be more than 10 in a public space. And that was one of the key points of all these manifestations that were questioning the state of emergency. And so in the performance, as you can imagine, as you can see, there was 24 people, plus the followers of all these people, plus those who came to see the final scene, but they were all alone. And all the performers were physically alone performing in one time and space. So they were all stopped by police, and police very quickly realized that there was something happening all over the city, but it was falling in a sort of a gray zone of the law, because in the only moment when there was a gathering of objects, and basically there's nothing to do about that. And also the gathering of, although the objects, like apparently, look like the objects of the executive power, because this is police sirens, and are the symbol of state power. They were actually were held by people in hands as a metaphorically and symbolically charged gesture. And what is important to say that also the use of emergency lights in public space is penalized, and it costs very expensive, because the fine for one emergency light is around 2,000 euros in France. But actually, and it's regulated by the driving code, and the driving code says that you cannot use blue lights in any for any reason, but this norm explicitly refers to vehicles. And so, because nobody thought that pedestrians could do it, and so basically this is another loophole in the legislation that allowed this performance to happen. It was completely legal. Basically, all these people holding the lights in the streets, it was completely legal. So it was sort of a way to test and the boundaries of the state of law versus the state of emergency, let's say. So all of the performers were stopped by police. They had a very, very strong legal argument. So they have the invoices in their pockets, and they perfectly knew the legislation that I'm explaining to you now. They were never calling performance. They were, when they were asked, what are you doing? They were saying that I'm walking from the point A to point B and holding an object that belongs to me. So that's it. And that's how, that's how it happens. But we never knew if we will be able to finish or not. And I was also performing myself, so I was also doing one of the walking trajectories. And so when I arrived to the center, there was actually around 30 police persons of special forces there with huge guns. And it was a very difficult interrogatory, that because I had to go and say, like, yeah, I'm the responsible person for that. What was nice is that the performance had a timing, because the timing of the performance was the timing of Art of Fugue. The performance started when Art of Fugue was starting all over the Parisian urban space, and performance was finished when the Art of Fugue was finished. But it's funny to say this, because Art of Fugue is an unfinished musical score. It's the opus magnum of Bach, of polyphonic writing, but it's an unfinished score. But so when the musical score was stopped, the performance was stopped. And so when I was taking part in this interrogatory, I was just basically looking at my watch and saying, okay, like I have to hold 10 more minutes and then performance will end by itself. And that's how it went. So nobody, so they were not, the lights were not confiscated or whatever. So yeah, that's it.
So this was a work that was acquired by Muka in 2019. And what this meant or what was agreed was that the museum would receive one copy of the work, meaning that the museum would receive the materials related to the work, which we called the archive, and also the rights to reenact the work. These were the agreements that were made. And of course, as you heard, since this is such a complex work, it raised a lot of questions about what, how these rights to reenact the work, for example, what this would mean in practice. And Katya will guide us through how we took on the putting together of the archive and of working with the rights to reenact the work.
Thank you. Yeah, I will very briefly introduce the approach to this acquisition that we discussed with Bart in the very beginning, and we decided that, like, the first point is initially it was a site-specific performance that was supposed to happen, that happened in relation to very specific political events and very specific geography of one city. But so the first question that was raised, can it be reenacted or not? And if yes, how the site specificity of the work would be translated into these reenactments? And the second question that was raised is how we create the acquisition materials for an event that happened in one day, in one place, several years ago. So basically how we approach this question, which is almost irresolvable. And so what we did, we created this structure. And from there, I developed it into subcategories. So it was decided that Augen music can exist if it comes to present Augen music as a site-specific piece that happened in Paris in 2016, it would be presented in the form of an exhibition, and it can also be reenacted in a site-specific way. And so the most part of the archive that is here, except point two, is the archive of the performance from 2016. And so you have the score, then the audio files, video files, the map, research production documents, and as a bonus folder, testimonials from performers. So for example, the score is just a text document that describes what I said. The video documentation has 24, yeah, because for example, each performer was accompanied by a camera. So you have files from 24 gates of Paris, plus the documentation of the final scene, which is one-hour file, and the Google and the map, for example, was I had to artificially make it because in reality I was using the Google Maps. So all these materials are archival materials, but do not have yet an exhibition, a fixed exhibitional form. The reenactment score is still under construction and raises so many questions. So from there, let's maybe go into discussion.
Thank you. One of the questions that rose was the fact that the work can get an afterlife in different shapes. It can be installed in exhibition setup, it can be reenacted, but you also see other possibilities for the work to live on. And these are possibilities that you have not, that you want to develop, but you haven't developed them yet. And they're, of course, part of your work. And this is also something you call these shapes derivative artworks. And this is also something very complex to grasp. Where does the work, where does the acquisition begin? Where does the end? Maybe you want to add something to that?
Yeah, but then would you like to show a picture because it's in the PowerPoint? Yeah, because or I have to go back to the PowerPoint. What Lotte is speaking about is for example that this is an installation of the lights that can function as an installation, as a sculpture, as a separate artwork. It's basically, so it comes, that's props from the performance in the first place, but it also, if you see it like this in an exhibition space, it can perfectly work as a work itself without you knowing that it somehow comes from the performance. Another work that would have the same nature would be the video work that was not commissioned yet. That would be the installation of 24 screens, like a surveillance screens, like a wall of surveillance screens in the police station, where each screen would be dedicated to each trajectory of the performance. And so this installation, you could also witness and look at it as if it was an autonomous work. And so basically, did I answer your question?
So both the fact that this is a work that can develop in different ways, and also the fact that it's a site-specific work, which is very strongly linked to political and geographical situation, made it difficult to think about the conditions that would be met for the work to be reenacted.